on Babylon FM. Hey, hey! It's Sunday, June the 27th, 2021. What's up, what's up, what is up?
Vanny Bash Kurdistan, it's your boy, me, Van, aka Dilawi, coming at you live from the best radio station you've ever heard in your life. You know it's Babylon FM, mate.
Wake up, it's time to start. On this last week of June, Dilawi, if you could just stop playing with your. Don't stop playing.
If we weren't so poor and we
could
fix the mics, I wouldn't have a problem.
Let's not start the show that way. Okay, I'm gonna try my best. I made a promise to myself that I'm gonna go a whole week not being angry or making fun of you. So Dilawi, how you doing? How's it going?
I'm good. How are you?
Doing excellent.
So you promise this whole week you won't make fun of me?
Yeah.
So I can make fun of you, like your hair sucks.
No.
You look weird.
No. It's gonna break if you do that, and I'm gonna attack back at you. But I'm gonna be honest with you, Dilawi, I'm not really feeling that great this morning, considering all the different problems that we had over the weekend, but also, I kind of have a
What
headache.
You just heard is a clip from Babylon FM, a radio station based out of Ain Kawa, a Christian neighborhood on the outskirts of Erbil, the capital of the Kurdistan Autonomous Region in Iraq. It's hosted by a two-man duo, Noor Matti and Mivan Mandalawi. Both men spent quite a bit of time living abroad in the West, so when they moved to Erbil, they decided to start Iraq's only English-language radio station. I sat down with Noor and talked to him about many things ranging from why he decided to leave a relatively peaceful life in the US to what he thinks are problems facing the Kurdistan region and Iraq in general today. Noor was raised in Detroit, Michigan. He says he's part of a generation going through an identity crisis, growing up in places in which they have no roots in. After graduating from college, he decided to explore and try to find a place where he belonged. So he tricked his parents and bought a one-way ticket to Erbil.
So I like to call myself as part of this new group of generation where people are growing up in places that they don't have roots at. So I grew up in Detroit, even though I'm originally from here. And a lot of young people like us, we have these identity crises. We don't know where we belong, what we're doing with our lives. So, after I graduated from Wayne State, I decided to just explore, see where I belong. And one of the places was here. I said, Mom, Dad, can I come just visit? I wanted to just reconnect with my cousins. I haven't had no contact with them for 16 years. So can I just check it out? And they accepted. And then I tricked them. It was a one-way ticket. I didn't go back. I quickly found a job here. Slowly, I started establishing myself. And I saw lots of potential here. This was back in 2008, 2009. There was a lot of potential here. I felt like things were building, so I wanted to be part of that process. And at the same time, on a personal level, I come from a minority group, and that minority group was getting attacked and derailed since 2003, and the population numbers were going down really bad. So I wanted to be an example for minorities that, hey, you can still live here. And I wanted to eventually help people to be able to make it here.
Noor is a Chaldean. Who are Chaldeans? Well, in a nutshell, Chaldeans are a Catholic Christian ethnic group originating primarily in Iraq. But due to religious and ethnic persecution, poor economic conditions, and lack of security, most Chaldeans have fled Iraq, and now there is actually more Chaldeans living in the US than Iraq itself. Although in the Kurdistan region people can practice their religion freely, it's still a pretty conservative society with a Muslim majority. So for someone like Noor to switch from liberal, open-minded America to conservative, not so much open-minded Iraq, it is something that's pretty unusual.
Yeah, so when I was here for the first time in those days, it's easier for people who have roots to kind of balance it and understand it. Oh, that's why things are like this. That's why things are more conservative. So it was easy for me to adapt, but definitely that was one of my goals in life here, was to try to make this place more of an open society, because when you do that, everybody is able to coexist and live. So for example, with the radio station, we try and help and promote peace and coexistence as much as possible. And of course, we do this with the Western culture, let's say, in terms of the music and in terms of the media and these kind of things. And that's a battle of its own, right? Trying to make the upcoming generations to be as open-minded as possible. And so it was a shock to answer your question, but it wasn't like it's impossible for us to not change. And things have changed. Thankfully, I've seen a big progress where people are more open-minded today than they were 10, 15 years ago.
In 2014, ISIS took over large swaths of land in Iraq. Wherever they took over, they implemented their hardline Sharia laws, such as restricting women's rights, brutal punishments such as beheadings, and banned smoking and music. They even jammed Babylon FM's radio waves to prevent it from reaching lands under their control in Nineveh and Mosul. During those days, when ISIS was at its strongest, pushing for a more liberal, open-minded rock was dangerous work.
Yeah, those were the war days, as we like to call them. We used to have radio wars at that time because, you know, after ISIS took over Nineveh and Mosul in 2014, they purposely were trying to jam our radio. They were jamming Babylon FM because it was penetrating the airwaves of Mosul, and it was the only communication of means between Mosul civilians and the people from the outside of their city. So, you know, we were threatened. I was personally threatened at that time by you know, these terrorists, and it was really dangerous time, 2014, 2015, and early 2016. So it gave you even a more reason to, we were even more passionate, and this is why we're still alive today with the radio station. It's beyond just a job here. We are part of a movement of saying, hey, this is okay. Being different is okay. Listening to English music is okay. And at that time, in 2014, 2015, it was on a very personal level when ISIS was purposely jamming the radio as it was entering Mosul.
In Iraq, it seems like whenever there's progress, whenever people build, something happens and all that progress is suddenly gone and the situation deteriorates. Iraq being in constant conflict causes many problems such as a lack of safety, a bad economic situation, and unemployment, especially for the youth. These problems bring other problems such as depression, anxiety, and mental illness. I asked Noor how everything affected him emotionally.
Well, of course, you go through these different cycles of depression. Like a lot of people, you know, young people are prone to depression. You know, a lot of, I didn't have any much anxiety, but just a lot of just being down and sad and like, hey, you know, what the hell, we built all this and it gets destroyed. You build and destroy it. You see your civilization of 3,000-4,000 years getting destroyed, and ISIS is comfortably posting that video on Twitter. So, that puts you on an endless cycle of depression. But again, all these things gave you the motivation more to keep on working, to keep on pushing, and do as many different things as possible to be part of the positive movement here in Iraq.
There is a gap between Noor and Babylon FM's movement and the old cultural status quo. In 20 years, the way Kurdistan and Iraq will look can go either way. People like Noor want to see a more open-minded society that accepts everyone for who they are. But at the same time, they also want to see the local cultural flourish, not disappear. This is how Noor wants to see Iraq in 20 years.
Definitely more open-minded. First and foremost, more a better situation for females. We have a big problem here until now of honor killing and women not having their rights. So we want that to change. The biggest benefit for our society, if we're making a more open-minded and liberal, is that the women in our society will finally have their rights to be able to choose and live their life like they want to. I feel like the females, unfortunately, here are still not able to comfortably live their lives. I know that. I have sisters. I have a wife. I have cousins, and I know and I see that. And so, unfortunately, the Middle East is still not a great place for the female population. So I want it to be a better place. And of course, on the same topic, minorities not feel like, you know, they are under pressure by the bigger populations. No matter what ethnic minority or religious minority you belong to, you should not worry or fear or try to hide your identity just because of satisfying, you know, the larger population. So, but there's also a balancing that's really important, right? We're promoting all these things, but I'm not for example, young kids to be talking in English with their parents at home. Like, we don't want to destroy and encroach the ancient cultures that we have here. We need to be smart and have a balance of that.
These days, we live in an era of globalization. If you look at it, most people on Earth wear the same clothes, t-shirt, jeans, suits, Nike sneakers, or even start to listen to the same music. It might be in a different language, but it seems like every country has a famous rapper. Keeping the balance between old and new is tough. Noor says the government and public officials should be doing more to preserve these ancient cultures so they don't disappear.
The government needs to seriously endorse and support like heritage and the Ministry of Culture more, so that they have the tools to, you know, also highlight the important things in our culture. You know, our clothes, our traditional clothes, our music, our celebrations, our festivals and things like that. At the same time, people need to be better influencers. They need to set examples in a better way, right? So people who are public officials in our society need to understand that thousands of people are looking at them. So what you say do affects those people. So yeah, push this message of coexistence, make listening to English music cool. But at the same time, that person needs to also say, hey, your tradition is important. That's why your tradition is special. And you should also think about that. And I think between that, having government support and positive influencers, then I think we can have a good balance.
Iraq, contrary to popular beliefs, is a multi-ethnic state. But minorities in recent times have been marginalized and discriminated against. I asked Noor, since he is part of a minority group, to tell us about the situation for minorities today.
Yeah, you know, unfortunately, minorities in the Middle East, no matter what, religious or ethnic minorities, have always been disadvantaged, just like anywhere in the world, right? We hear about these unfortunate stories of minorities are always suppressed. And the pain of minorities is double than the average citizen when you look at problems. Like, for example, the Iraq War that happened, after that, everybody had problems. But when you're a minority, you have a double problem because you're specifically targeted and you don't have a voice. So unfortunately, that is the case also here. Of course, the Kurdistan region is a lot better than compared to other places in the world or other places in the Middle East. Minorities are freely able to exercise their religion, but that doesn't mean we're a perfect society here. We too also unfortunately have problems here. And that eventually needs to be addressed. The subject of minorities is of course important, because if minorities don't have their rights, then everybody else don't technically have their rights, because if they shut down this, then eventually they'll shut down that and this and that. So it's important, the development of minority rights in anywhere in the Kurdistan region and Iraq. And honestly, I feel like there's still much more to go, and we have a lot of societies that were destroyed and haven't been brought back. For example, the large Jewish community that we used to have in the Kurdistan region in Iraq was unfortunately deleted, and there's been no attempt at trying to rebuild it. And of course, the same thing with other disadvantaged minorities like the Mandaeans and other minorities who are on the brink of extinction, like the Kaka'is. And so there needs to be a lot of work done. And again, this goes back to the political leaders and public officials being a good example and forcing policies that really empower minorities. And that would be a good example for the rest of the region, of course, if that happens.
During ISIS, there was a genocide of Yazidi people in the Sinjar region in Iraq. I asked Noor if he was afraid at any time that the same could happen to Kurdistan's and Iraq's large Christian population, and also to other minority groups.
Yeah, of course. And actually, a lot of people left the Kurdistan region when that whole ISIS thing happened in 2014. A lot of people left Erbil. They stayed somewhere temporarily. And many of them left and didn't come back because they thought, we're next. We're right next door. Literally, ISIS was 5 kilometers away from of Erbil city, we can almost say, the vicinity of Erbil. So that was a very scary time. And unfortunately, it was uncertain. We didn't know if ISIS was going to be able to eventually take over the Kurdistan region, because it just kept on expanding and expanding. And they even knocked on the doors of Baghdad. So if they were threatening the capital, what do you think, you know, what do you think would have happened here? So unfortunately, that led to a lot of a population lock for the minorities. And of course, the young people in general, the young people of the Kurdistan region had the opportunity, took that visa and left. And they said, forget this. And we are still paying the price for that, because we lost so many young people to the West because of that 2014 invasion. It's unfortunate. But yeah, those were the darkest moments.
Along with Babylon FM, Noor started and runs Shamla Foundation, an NGO which helps the mainly disenfranchised Christian community. With a lack of help from local government and international community, Noor put it on himself to help people who needed to be helped.
Yeah, with the problems the Kurdistan region faces, that they're endless. Right now, as if, you know, getting off of the pandemic wasn't enough. You know, we're just starting to build back from ISIS. We have, unfortunately, sadly, Turkish air bombardment in the northern area, where villages are being emptied once again. And a lot of them are also Christian villages in the north, Assyrian Christian villages. And, you know, nobody's helping them. There is no mandate. There's no policy. You know, the Iraqi government doesn't provide any urgent assistance. So, you know, small and grassroots movements like our NGO, the Shama Foundation, is trying to ease the pain as much as possible. So currently we're busy with helping the shepherds who have lost their livelihood because they can't enter their village anymore. And we're doing different things from shelter to food to, you know, any kind of basic services that they are in need of in the north. But that is what's happening now. But since 2014, of course, we've done a variety of things of trying to ease the pain for minorities, including, you know, emergency assistance such as medicine, food, and rebuilding their homes once they went back to Nineveh, and, you know, jobs. It's so crucial, you know, when you don't have livelihood, what's the point of you coming back? So minority groups are always feeling like they're disenfranchised by the governmental authorities, because the government here is all about hookups. If you know somebody, you're in. If not, then you're disadvantaged. So we're trying to help as many people as possible from the Sama Foundation.
Kurdistan and Iraq in general is now coming out of a period of darkness. First the Iraq war, then ISIS, then COVID. What keeps Noor going? What's stopping him from packing his bag and returning to the relatively peaceful life back in the States?
For me, what keeps me going is my heritage, my history, right? So, you know, I take pride in where I'm from. We are coming from one of the oldest civilizations in the world. And it would be a shame for me just to turn my back on and just live my life comfortably in the West. When we have 4,000 or 5,000 year history here. So if that doesn't matter for you, then, you know, I don't know what does. And it's really important that we save these ancient cultures, these ancient societies, because they are really a treasure to Iraq. You know, other countries, they protect, they try to export their cultures. And unfortunately here, we don't do that. So I feel like, you know, people like me and like-minded people like me, we're on a mission to help save that ancient heritage. So when a population is deleted, that language is gone. When a population is deleted, the traditions are gone. And nobody will appreciate the history that existed from here. So that's what keeps me going, is trying to help these minority groups as much as we can so that Iraq in the future and the Kurdistan region in the future becomes something that is blossoming with different cultures and different traditions. And that would be appreciated a lot more by the outside world as well.
I remember hearing about Babylon in school when I was young, but even though it's one of the most famous civilizations in the ancient world, at school, it was barely talked about. When I went to Kurdistan, I realized Babylon was here. It's something that the average person, particularly people not from that area of the world, know about. Earlier in the pod, Noor mentioned that he was afraid of his culture fading away amidst the globalization of the current world, and that Iraq doesn't export its culture. What message does Noor have for the Kurdish people abroad who moved away because of the war or economic reason, or maybe their parents moved and they were raised abroad, just like in his case?
This is not just for the Kurdish population, of course. It's for all the different ethnic and religious minor groups from the Kurdistan region and from Iraq. And that is, there's a need for you here. Living a comfortable life is not fulfilling. You need to have a passion in your life. And here, there's a lot of different opportunities for you, right? Because we haven't built this country yet. And in the West, I want to, first of all, just appreciate all the wonderful work people are doing there. And it makes me so proud seeing all their accomplishments. But do consider that, your knowledge and your expertise can help far more people, and your influence can be a lot stronger if it's being invested here in the Middle East and here in the Kurdistan region and in Iraq. So do consider coming back and try to help this place in any way that you can. And you will hopefully find your happiness, right? we always are looking for that like end game for us where we are happy with our life. And I'm certain a lot of people around the world are not happy with their lives. And that is because maybe they haven't found their right place in this world. So if they should, if they come and try, and who knows, they might finally find a purpose in their lives.
A lot of developing countries are facing the problem of brain drain, where educated young people go to the West to pursue careers in fields that they are passionate about. This is what Noor thinks Iraq needs to thrive and will bring opportunities back to Iraq and Kurdistan so educated people could stay and build their lives in the country.
Yeah, what we need is actually expertise. A lot of things that people have learned abroad, we need that here so that we have better systems, better structures. You know, something as simple as we're losing doctors. We have less doctors to people ratio here, and we need to have our doctors back. If not, then you don't have proper healthcare services. That times every single other sector. We are in need of these people to come back and help us prosper, because without it, we can't really build. And, you know, it goes back to this issue of, if you don't have the right building blocks, then you're not going to have a bright future. This whole structure is going to fall. No matter how many apartment complexes you build, it doesn't matter if we don't have the proper building blocks, which is a right health sector and a right educational sector and so on and so forth. So that's what we are in need of, is we need people to help us rebuild again.
When I traveled to Kurdistan, I didn't tell my parents that I was there. It's probably because people have the wrong perception that there is a lot of insecurity there, a lot of terrorism. This is the message that Noor has to the people who've never been to or heard of Kurdistan.
We need your tourism money. We need visitors. We, you know, back in the 70s and the 60s, and the 50s even, or in the 60s and 70s, Iraq was a big hub for tourism. Lots of Europeans would come here and it was a normal thing. And losing that has hurt this place tremendously. We are in so need of being connected with the rest of the world, and we need people to come and visit us and check it out. Like, there's a good amount of fun to have here, and it's not all dark and gloomy. And at the same time, you learn a lot. So we just need people to come visit us. We have safe airports. We have good hotels, and just come and just check it out. The word Iraq is stigmatized, of course, after all these years, but it's really not that bad. You can go and have some kebab in Mosul right now and you'll feel safe. Trust me, it's not that bad. So it's just everything destroyed, unfortunately. But we need people to come visit us and be able to reconnect again. The hospitality we have here is definitely a special one. People love visitors here. We treat them with love. And we love it when people come here. We like to tell them about our cultures, about our food, and about everything. So, you know, the hospitality we have here in the Kurdistan region is really compared to nothing. It's really special here.
And that is the end of the podcast. I would like to give a special thanks to Omar Hamid Biato, my partner on this project, and also a special thanks to Noor and Mivan for letting us into their studio and allowing us to listen in on their show. And lastly, a special thanks to you. Thank you for listening. There'll be more interviews coming in the future, so I hope to see you again soon. Peace.